Ah, it's calm now, wildebeest. It's beautiful out here.
Cool, now's our chance. Let's go for the dam.
Should we go?
Yeah.
Right, hello everybody. 1 second. We are not going to probably be doing a drive today. There is a brief hiatus in the tremendous squall that has been having. We've been having today. I've now lost my lens cap, which is an absolute disaster. Really, that really is quite a disaster right now. Anyway, we'll try and sort that out as we go along. It is unlikely that we are going to make it through the drive, I'm afraid. Please excuse me scrabbling around here like a total idiot. There we go, I found it. But what we are going to do, there's a brief hiatus, so we're going to quickly turn the car on and we're going to go down towards the dam and we'll just have a quick look there. And if you are watching this, this is of course Safari Live, if you stumbled across it, this is the pre-show to the show, which is not going to exist today on account of the cyclone, whose name is, what's it called again, Vim? Nat.Geo or something like that. Yes, there we go. And it's been squalls on us all day long. We tried the tent this morning. It was absolutely hopeless. Wind and rain blew into the tent, which was no good at all. And so we thought we'd just come out quickly and show you how the weather is. Maybe we'll see an animal, but I don't know about that. We'll head down to the water's edge and see if there's been any change. We've had about 40 millimeters of rain so far, I imagine, which is more than was predicted, but that's not surprising. And I think that I still don't think it's going to be enough to sort of fill up the dams, but possibly enough to make a decent sized puddle there. And we're expecting this sort of weather today and tomorrow. And despite the roof that we have on the car, and despite the tent setup that we have, I'm afraid the rain was just too vicious this morning. What was that, Kirsten? Right, we're just moving down towards the Djuma Dam now. Great flapping of our roof. Our Flintstone mobile. And when we started, we came out here and it was actually quite nice. We thought, oh, well, it'll be fine. And as we got out of the camp, it started to drive down out of the sky again. And it's all blasting in from the southeast. So if we turn our backs to the southeast, it's pretty much dry where I'm sitting now. But as soon as you turn anywhere other than northwest, it's hopeless. Still, it's quite nice to be out today. I haven't been out yet. Hello, Sarah. You say, am I the only one out? I am, because we're probably not going to complete the drive, I'm afraid. We'll stay out for as long as we can, but there's no point in risking further equipment, I'm afraid. So we'll just have a quick look around here. See what we can see, and then we'll probably have to head back. If the squalls, you see, these squalls keep coming through intermittently, and it's just not worth being around for them. Right, well, there is some water in this dam. It's quite nice. We'll get you a position where you can see it. How's that, Vim? Ah, that's positively balmy out here. I mean, in Scotland, they'd be sunbathing. As you can feel the wind, I'm sure. Well, you probably can't feel it, but you can certainly hear it. Blasting up here. And I can hear frogs chirruping away. Very pleased, of course, that there is some rain in the offing. My tadpoles are not calling yet, I'm afraid. You can, of course, ask any questions you'd like. Hashtag Safari Live, questions at WildEarthTV. Ooh. What is swimming? Just a large terrapin. Oh, yes, coming out of the water now. John, you say, does this water force underground insects out of the ground? That's an interesting question. No, I don't think it does always. You know, I think if somehow many underground insects, like termites, for example, will just close up their termite mounds. Ants will probably do the same. And, well, larvae like... Well, not larvae, but young cicadas, for example, that live under the ground for a very long time. Well, I don't think they pop up every time it rains. So, no, I don't think so. I'm sure there's some insects that would be forced out. But interestingly, John, I mean, I know it's not an insect, I know it's an arachnid, but we were looking at a baboon spider's web the other day, and we were chatting about how we thought maybe animals are able to tell if there's very bad weather coming. And this baboon spider had covered up its nest completely. So they make a hole in the ground. It's the equivalent of a tarantula, and they make a hole in the ground, and she had covered it in a very fine roof of silk. Now, that's fairly pointless unless it's to sort of keep things out, because she's not a web hunter. She chases her prey and catches it. And she'd covered over the top of this web, and I think it was in preparation for rain, because they cannot dig themselves another hole if they lose the one hole. Well, Vim, I think there's another brief hiatus. Shall we carry on? Mm-hmm. Hold on, everybody. Anthony, you say, would the animals be out during the rain? Well, it depends, Anthony, where you think they've gone during the rain. They will most likely, though, Anthony, as you're probably guessing, be in thick bush. And so I certainly haven't seen hide nor hair of a mammal since we came on our adventure so far. So I don't know if we'll see any mammals. We'll just ease our way gently down this road, and if it does begin to come down again, I'm going to have to turn the car sharpish to the right-hand side. It's not cold at all. I mean, it's actually very warm. It's quite pleasant, really. It wouldn't be pleasant for 3 hours in this, though, I don't think. Do you, Vim?
No.
And we got a little bit of cabin fever, did Vim and I, so we thought we'd better come out and see what's going on out here. We might be lucky and find a lion lying up in the clearing, looking a bit miserable. Perhaps a leopard. It'd be quite nice to see those little royal cubs. Gary, I don't know the answer to your question because I haven't been near. I think the best examples of weaver birds' nests at the moment are the ones at Cheetah Plains, and you want to know how they're holding up in the face of Cyclone Demona. What's her name again? Deneo. Cyclone Deneo. So I don't know, but I think you'll find they'll be fine. They're extremely well attached to the trees, and I mean they're designed to withstand maybe not winds quite like this, but certainly maybe a few poorly built ones would have been knocked clean out, but I think the rest will be fine. Dom or John, I can't hear exactly with the wind, you're saying are there any animals that thrive, it's Dom, in the rain? Well, remember, animals, of course, are not just mammals. None of the mammals like this kind of weather very much. But plenty of other animals, the frogs love it, the terrapins love it, the tortoises enjoy it, they come out too. So the reptiles and amphibians find it quite pleasurable. Very few mammals. I guess there must be a few duck species that quite like it too. Not many of the birds though. The birds of course have to constantly worry about getting their feathers inundated, because if they do, they will just plummet to the ground, and that of course is a bit of a disaster if your main defense is to fly. And then I suppose eventually, once the rain stops and the heat comes back, well, then I suppose you'll find a lot of insects that will be very happy with the extra moisture and the heat. The insects, of course, need the heat. Just don't want to run over a little terrapin. Normally they get out of the way. Now, Cat in Tampa of course, the big question about the big cats when it starts to rain is, will they be around marking their territory after the rain? Yes, of course they will, absolutely. But will they choose to do so while the weather is still like this? I'm not so sure. But we might find out. We might be very lucky. Yeah, I think we'll just keep going south until the squall starts and then we'll turn north. I'm pretty sure we'll have another squall fairly soon. Hello, Daniel, all the way from Bonnie, Scotland. You say, do elephants like all the water? They do. When it's, I mean, look, they don't, I don't think they like this weather. They disappear. I've very seldom seen an elephant in this weather. I think the wind makes them feel a little bit chilly, but they do love water. And I'm sure you've been watching when they've been swimming around the place. But I don't think they necessarily like this kind of, well, shall we say Scottish weather, Daniel? I suppose it's not very Scottish, actually, because it's warm. It's not cold. Yes, certainly no sign of any animal life at this stage. We'll push it down to Twin Dams and see if we don't get lucky there, maybe with the royal family. Also be nice to see the Umluamati and see if it has actually flowed. Apparently you all want to know about Hip Scar and my story about the Majingalans. I don't know what's going on with that, I'm afraid, at all. I just know that he was quite badly injured, looked like he was going to die, and I'm afraid I've got no idea what his fate has been. Does anybody else have any idea? No. Yes? Ah, he died yesterday and he was eaten by vultures. Well, that's a good noble death for a lion, I feel. I suppose, you know, to be injured in battle and then die and be, well, contribute to ecology by being eaten by vultures. So that's interesting. I don't know where he died. That information comes from Tristan, so he might be able to tell us where he died. But the Majingalan Coalition was almost, I mean, you know, I was out of the area for the majority of their dominance period. There's an Impala. Go film it. Don't run away. You're the only animal we've seen. And the Majingalan, I mean, when I was at Londolozi, I began there in 2007, well, for my second stint. And the Majingalana coalition was nothing to be heard of, and the Mapochos had just come in, and everyone thought, well, these guys are going to dominate for years and years, because there were five of them. They killed, I think, upward of 9 or 10 lionesses at least during their big takeover, so a bit like the Birminghams did when they came in here. And then these sort of unfancied males came in about two and a half years later. They came and chased those Mapochos out, and they have been now around probably since, I mean, Tristan, you must correct me if I'm wrong here, but I think they've been around since 2010. Now that's 6 years, and 6 years for a coalition of males is quite astounding. So they have done a remarkable job. They must be pushing 12 years old by now. I'm not going to bother with that bird. It's too high up. And yeah, only one of them, I think there were five to start with, I think. There were four, now there are three. And I don't think that that's surprising. I think it's astounding that they've done as well as they have and survived this long. It's always a bit sad, though, when the old warriors pack it up and have to press on. But they've been remarkably successful. I think probably the most successful, I've actually never seen them, but the most remarkably successful coalition that I've been around. Uh, Shannon, yes, the answer is one. You say, would any animals go to our camp to take cover? Well, actually two. There was a tortoise that came in this morning. She comes in almost on a daily basis. She wanders into the camp and in fact wandered into my room today, crawled under my desk, couldn't find a cave to again. That was very sweet. It was a little speaks hinge tortoise. It was very funny. And then there's a bush buck that likes to come into camp, but not for shelter. I think that's much more for I think the comfort of the absence of predators. I think that's why the bush buck in Nyala spend so much time there. Kirsten just reminding me there that the tortoise's name is Gregory, even though Gregory is a girl, but still called Gregory. Gregory likes the marulas that we have on the floor in the camp because we have an enormous marula tree. Is that it is now dropping its marulas, and for some reason our marula tree in camp has got marulas the size of sort of fairly large plums, and they fall out of the tree onto the tin roof under which we sleep, and it sounds like, well, it sounds like a pitched battle is going on in the night when the wind starts to blow. So I'm told. I don't wake up to it, but Kirsten and Connor complain bitterly every morning. Can you see any leopards, Jim? Oh, Trevor, initially it's quite nice. You say, what does the rain and excess water do with the mosquitoes? Initially, the mosquitoes don't like this weather because it's cold. Well, it's not cold, but it's cold for them. They don't like the howling wind. It means they can't smell the carbon dioxide that is being exhaled by their victims. But eventually, of course, this weather is going to make puddles for them to breed in, and they will become more numerous when the heat comes back. Now, I'm not sure the mosquitoes of this area could become more numerous, but they're certainly going to do a very good job of trying when the sun does come back. So we'll have two nights of peace while the weather persists like this, and then I'm afraid I think it's going to be fairly dismal on the mosquito front. I have never seen mosquitoes like I have this year. I never normally get bitten. This year I've been bitten often. Now we'll also, from this position at Twin Dams, be able to get a view of the southeastern horizon, and I'll give you an idea of the weather that's coming in. I would very much like to see a small leopard cub today, drenched or otherwise. And Jessica, I think not. You say, would some animals struggle to find prey in this animal, in this weather? I think you find that they're probably well adapted to it. They know where to look. They can smell. I suppose that the smell that their prey might leave could easily be washed away. So maybe they struggle a little bit. But if they walk around for long enough, they're going to spot something. And of course, once it's found, it's much easier to kill in weather like this because it's much less aware with the wind and the rain and the noise. Where was the royal family last seen, Vim? It was around here, wasn't it? In the Mluamati. Okay. So no leopards just yet. We might go, I wonder if we can go up the Mluamati. We probably can. I'm not sure the signal will hold in this car though. Now Tayla found an amazing, amazing frog sighting around here. Everybody, there's not going to be a crash cut to anyone else because there isn't anyone else out at the moment, but I will immediately try and get into a better position. I'd quite like to see if there are any bullfrogs. Lots of frogs calling. Mary, you're wondering about snakes and whether we might see more of them out in this weather. I think it's probably a little bit like it is with the insects, where you might see them once it starts to warm up a bit. You see, if I go down there, we're not going to have any signal. I'm going to have to go this way. We'll keep an eye out for tracks, but of course, once the weather has turned like this, tracks are few and far between, unless the animal has walked immediately. Shall we push it for Buffleshook Dam? What do you think? Do you think that would be taking a chance? Alright, let's go up the Mruamati. We are wondering if we won't be able to find these leopards, so let's do that first. Alright, hold on everybody. We're going to go up the river in the rain. Oh, Kudu. There's a Kudu. Hello, Kudu. While we look at that very pretty Kudu, Virginia, you're wondering about the road damage and whether it will be repaired after the rain. Yes, eventually it will. It's not, of course, job to try and maintain the roads, and as fast as they can be fixed, they will be. That's an interesting call. You hear that? Tree, 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 tree. That is the call of the striped kingfisher. And I don't think I've heard a striped kingfisher since I've been at Djuma. That's very cool. Striped kingfisher, I'm not going to take my book out. Tiny little kingfisher, about that big. Looks almost like a brown hooded kingfisher, but much smaller. And, well, unsurprisingly, with stripes on its belly. Righty, let's carry on. Try not to get stuck here. There goes Kudu. And Katerina, you're wondering about muddy soil and whether or not it makes it difficult for predators to hunt. Katerina, you know, the soil here is really very well drained. It's very sandy. There's very little in the way of clay-based soil here. So I don't think it makes much difference. Certainly, you know, when we go for a walk in the rain, we don't find that our shoes become inundated with mud or covered in mud. Yes, there are patches of mud, but I don't think it makes any difference. Well, somebody's come up here following tracks of predators this morning. I suspect quite strongly that it was... Was it you and Tristan? Tristan says it was him. Tristan is in the final control. Tayla may well be heading out fairly soon on account of the fact that the weather seems to be okay. Tristan, of course, is now occupying himself with a very important wildlife task. He's teaching the others in the final control what it is to be a jigsaw puzzle. It's very clever. The jigsaw puzzle obviously has a picture of a zebra on it, but they're not allowed to look at the box. Well done, Tristan. Well, there's an insect answer for you. There are monarch butterflies all over this place, and this area that we're in now tends to be the most butterfly-rich or butterfly-active area on the reserve. Right. I'm quite astounded that we're still out here, to be honest. But we shall keep going. Kristen, you're thinking of the avian members of our family here, the birds, and you want to know how the weather affects them. Well, birds, like I said, have got to keep their feathers dry. They cannot fly with wet feathers. And so I think you'll find largely that they avoid going out in the rain. There are some that will fly from tree to tree, but largely they will stay in thick bush and try and stay as dry as possible. It's almost impossible for a raptor to fly in the rain. They very quickly will get wet. Yes, they have the oils to protect their feathers from water, from getting too wet, but eventually the water will get through. So there's not a great deal of flying about. The vultures sit on the top of trees and look absolutely miserable. Not that a vulture ever looks much else other than miserable. But the rest of the birds tend to stay home. That said, I've seen one or two flitting around here. Obviously we had the striped kingfisher. And just to... Obviously you can see that we have the rain roof on, so it's going to be very difficult to show you any birds, and that's they're pretty much at eye level. Now, Carson, we mentioned the striped kingfisher, which is a first for me at Djuma. Plenty of them in the south of the reserve, and you want to know how many more species of kingfisher we have here. Well, we have the woodland kingfisher, he of the ubiquitous chip-prrr, chip-prrr. Then we have the striped kingfisher, which we've just heard. Prrr. Then we have... Are we going to make it under here? Shall I just go for it? And then we have the... Which goes... that was the brown-hooded kingfisher that goes, pity for you, pity for you, pity for you. Then we get a grey-hooded kingfisher, whose call I cannot remember. We get a pygmy kingfisher, which has a very sort of high-pitched cheeping call. We get a malachite kingfisher sometimes, sometimes a pied kingfisher as well. I suspect a half-collared kingfisher has been seen in these parts at some stage, but I've never seen one here. So that's quite a few kingfishers. That's eight of them. And a giant. I bet a giant's been seen here as well at some stage. I may have seen a giant here. That's nine. So just about all of them, pretty much. I can't think of another one, actually. I did say pied. Thank you, Kirsten. Kirsten, did you think of the pied all on your own, or did Tristan help you? Yes. I thought as much. I tell you what, I don't know. Oh, I've left out the mangrove kingfisher, of course, which we don't get here, on account of the fact that we don't have mangroves here. I said malachite before. I think I've got them all. I apologize for that, everyone. I did warn you, though. It's just a little bit difficult to maintain signal here at the moment. Aaron, in New Zealand, you're wondering about migratory patterns of birds and whether the storm will affect them. No, it won't affect migratory patterns because, of course, the birds only migrate between summer and winter. So between season, we're in the middle of summer. So, no, they're not going to go anywhere or disappear on account of the weather. But what it does do is bring in unusual birds. So yesterday we had a sighting of, well, we've had the striped kingfisher there. That could have been brought in by the storm. We have had also a... of monotonous larks on cheetah plains. We had them yesterday. That's unusual for this area. Did they come in as a result of the cyclone? I don't know for sure. They don't really know why they suddenly get up and move and come to different areas. Cyclone. What else have I seen? I've seen massive flocks. There's a pygmy kingfisher. The chances of us seeing it through here, I'm afraid, are very small. I'll keep trying. I've seen massive flocks of storks, you know, that wouldn't normally be seen in this area, being blown in along the front of a storm. Huge sort of dissensions of eagles, like lesser spotted and steppe eagles, being blown in front of a storm. You know, they're not on the back end of a migration, but just being blown forward. So yes, it does change the bird distribution. It was in here. There it is. I'm afraid with this roof on, there's no chance. We should just take the roof off here. The weather's perfect. Yes, sunglasses. Well, Christine, of course, what we can smell out here is the favorite word that I have here, the petrichor. You can smell the smell of the oils being released from the soil, which of course translates to us as the smell of new rain on the ground. That's starting to fade now because, of course, it's not new rain, it's been falling for some time, since last night at about, what time was it first squall? About 12, 2 o'clock maybe? VM's just unzipping a flap so that he can see out. Apparently those two little leopards were around here. And VM said that Hosanna had himself a mongoose for pudding yesterday. I can't think of anything worse to have for pudding than a mongoose, but there it is. Yeah, Robin, a very good question from you, and it's a worrying one for me. You're wondering about Shadow's cubs and how they will survive in weather like this. Now, Shadow and Karula have got the disturbing propensity to store their cubs in roadside culverts. Now, a roadside culvert, of course, is primarily there to drain water. So it's not really a good place to put cubs. Karula's latest two, of course, were born during the dry season, so it didn't really matter to them. That is not the case with Shadow's cubs, and so I would be worried that should a flash flood come, you know, pounding through, they might not be able to get away in time. Well, here are the tracks. This doesn't look very fresh, but there are tracks of a young male leopard. We'll go up to the pan. We did kind of go past the pan. We'll go up to the pan and then come back down this way. Just to see. Just to see. Oh, and Mary Ellen, you're wondering about Gwen's den and whether it would be flooded. No, hyenas are very clever. And in fact, it's one of the reasons I think that termite mounds are so heavily utilized by anything that wants a burrow. Because of the way they're built, of course, and often the way the termites, at least that aardvark, attack them, they don't go in underneath. They go in pretty much at the surface, about 2 or 3 feet off the ground. And that means they're a perfect place to hide from weather like this. And so a termite mound, if you were ever stuck out here, would be a good place to look for somewhere to hide. Well, as long as there wasn't a hyena or a warthog or a snake or a troop of vicious biting mongoose or something like that inside it. We're just going to look down. We're going to go up to the pan, turn around and come back and drive along a little bit more of the riverbed. You lift them at the pan. Okay, we'll go and look there. And Tim, yes and no. If you don't have a termite mound to lie in, I suppose the risk of a flash flood must be there. But it's not a huge risk, Tim. Flash floods are not a huge problem out here, mainly because the soil is so well drained. But it will eventually saturate, and then the chances can become much higher. But you'll find that a flash flood that will make something like the Mramati flow for a little while won't last long. It'll last a couple of hours, if that. But the bigger rivers do flood. The really big rivers do flood, like the Sand River, the Sabi River. And if you're a lodge owner in an area like that, you want to be very, very careful in weather like this. And then, I mean, some of the deeper drainage lines can flood, and then people can get stuck. And oft times have guests been stranded in these areas, probably not to their distress really, but they've been stranded in areas like this. There is the pan, at which I do not see any leopards. Now what we're going to do from here is head down into the riverbed and then head up north, so that we can get into the riverbed just opposite where the pan is. And we're going to be very careful about driving off-road today, because of course we've had more than 20 millimeters of rain, so unless it's on a very sandy crest, we'll have to be quite careful of going off-road. Lots of lovely frog sounds. The steering wheel feels like it's been wrapped in chewing gum. It's really... We haven't heard anything further about Shadow's cubs, I'm afraid. So hopefully we will at some stage. But that sighting area has still been zoned, and so we're not actually allowed to go into the area. A few drops of rain coming out of the southeast, but everything is, well, quite pleasant really. So while I continue looking for the leopards, another brave soul has decided to come out into Cyclone Demona, I think that's what it's called. Tayla Demona McCurdy would now like to greet you.
James, are you hinting something? Well, good afternoon to everybody, but I'm unfortunately not as brave as what James is, risking his life and getting his lovely, long, luscious locks wet on this very rainy and windy afternoon. But my name is Taylor, and on camera with me today is Brian in the thumb.
Hello.
Holiday. Yeah. It's too wet for him.
Yeah, enjoy the rain.
No, I don't blame the rim. That was a nice word. Yes, but I think that second wave is on its way, which is quite exciting. And I'm actually a bit silly. I wanted to go onto the top of quarantine and show you how this sort of dark ring lurking around us of clouds. It's interesting, but I'm so happy that we've had lots and lots of rain. I like the rain. So seeing as though James has gone a little bit further south and to the east, I thought we'd check out the northern section. So I'd actually like to go past Sydney's, and seeing as though that small little pan, oh hang on, it looks like one of the hyenas have unfortunately rummaged through camp and they've managed to drop a piece of litter. So I'm just going to very quickly jump out and grab it. That's a pocket. That's what happens as well when you get lots and lots and lots and lots and lots of wind, is that pockets and things go flying around, and sometimes you can't catch them. They get away from you, and I'm sure that all of you have done that very embarrassing sort of moment where you're sitting in a restaurant and your napkin or your serviette, depending where you are from in the world, flies off of your table and you very gracefully try to chase after it and you just can't, and it just always gets away with you and you end up looking like a complete buffoon. So that sometimes happens out here too, but I suspect it's what does Brent call the hyena?
Howard
could have been visiting camp as well. We'll see if we find any other remnants of Howard out here. I don't know. Brian's going. It's a tough one out here, and as James was saying earlier, you don't really know what you're going to see in weather like this, because the animals are cowering for shelter. And speaking about cowering for shelter, Isa, you were wondering more difficult driving through on the wet sand. It's actually quite nice. Like, if you look on the road now, you can see that this is quite hard and compact. There's quite a large amount of stones around here. This is actually really nice when it's wet, not too bad. But it's when you get to the sort of clay soils, the cotton soils in those areas, that it's not so great. So if you drive on roads like Hyena Road, you wouldn't be able to drive there. What would happen is you'd head on it and you'd end up sinking down into the ground. It's really quite terrible. And then you end up just churning up all the hard work that the maintenance team has done in repairing the roads. So we try and avoid that, as well as, of course, the erosion from the water when it comes pelting down in these sort of small rivers. Tracking and looking for animals, it becomes almost impossible unless you have a break in the weather like this, and then you get the animals also coming out from the shelter and then crossing the road. Then you'll see the tracks really, really nicely. But it's drizzling again. I suspect if another downpour comes through, and you can miss that, and you can miss the animal tracks very, very easily. We're on Shortcut Gallagher at the moment, just having a quick look around here. Ooh. People are talking on the radio. Let's hear what they have to... No, I have to dig now. Come, turn the game drive radio. There we go, now I can hear them. Well, that's nice. It seems as though this weather hasn't actually scared any of the guests away, which is surprising. And often when you come out here, big downpours of rains like we've just had are very, very easy for guests to sort of look out and go, sort of shake their heads and say, no, no, no. But that's good. I can hear Mike chatting around, and I think Aubrey and probably Rexon are going to pop their noses out too. But I'm sure if it gets heavy like it was, they'll head back to camp. I have to tell you all a very funny story. So when I was guiding down in the Eastern Cape, I'll never forget, we had this massive thunderstorm come over, and it was, we'd had so much rain the night before, and then in the morning it subsided, so we all went out on safari. And then that afternoon came, and sort of from about 1 o'clock it bucketed down. There was thunder and lightning, so it was actually quite hazardous. And I'd advise private vehicle, they were on their honeymoon, so they booked out the entire vehicle just for themselves, and they were from Ireland, and they were, I'll never forget them, they were a lovely, lovely couple. But they were set in their ways. They were going out on safari. So I said, we can't go out if there's lightning. And they said, okay, no, fair enough, it's dangerous. So as soon as the lightning stopped and the thunder stopped and it sort of moved off, we decided to go out. We were the only people out on the reserve out of 5 lodges. Not one other person wanted to go out in that weather, so off we went. And I think they were quite used to the terrible weather. We had 2 ponchos on each, well, all of us, so we landed up at raincoat, ponchos, and if we go, no trackers. And I said to them, I said, in this horrific weather, we're not gonna, and there was a lot mountainous. So a lot of the roads were closed, otherwise you just end up sliding off of the cliff, which you don't really want on your honeymoon. And off we went, and you won't believe it, we actually had the most unbelievable game drive, and we had the whole property ourselves. We didn't see too much for about the first hour, and then there was a break in the clouds, and we had elephants and lots of really exciting things. But the highlight was we had to take one road down that was really, really slippy. So we came down very, very slowly, and as we came around this bend, there were a couple of mud wallows, and it was a warthog. Can you believe, on a day like this, the clouds had just sort of opened slightly, this warthog was just, I don't know, having a little mud bath, I presume, and it came out, and then it ran in front of my vehicle. And as it ran in front of my vehicle, a lion was stalking it, and I didn't know that it was there. And it jumped out of the grass, a young male lion, he was probably only about 2.5-3 years old, and chased him, and didn't catch him though, which was unfortunate, because that would have been quite exciting. And well, after the end of that sighting, the clouds came back over and it bucketed down again. But it was so much fun, and I just thought to myself, it was the highlight of their trip actually. If we hadn't have gone out and done that, we never would have seen it. And no one believed us. They told us, telling campfire stories and all those sorts of things. But yes, it's wonderful out here. And if you would like to ask questions, please hashtag Safari Live on Twitter, or you can send them through to questions@wildearth.tv. Now, also just remember, every now and then you're going to see a cloth come across the camera. That's just Brian. He's just keeping the lens nice and clean. Oh, listen. Let's have a little listen to all these frogs. Oh, good old rusty squeaky brakes. Isn't that lovely? Gentle breeze for the moment, and all the frogs chirping. And Wayne, you were actually asking about the wind, and speaking about lightning in my story, lightning too. So basically Wayne was asking, is there much wind and lightning with the storm? Not yet. The wind is picking up again now. It sort of comes in intervals. Actually, what we're going to do is we're going to turn around and go the other way. At the moment, the wind is blowing in from the southeast, so it's blowing straight into us, and I'd prefer it if we could keep the camera as dry as possible, so we'll drive with the rain into our bum, which is good because we'll go straight towards Sydney's dam then and have a look and see if there's water in. I suspect though we could get a little bit of lightning, maybe not now, maybe a little bit later when the clouds sort of get quite heavy. Wind, yes. I mean the wind is probably gusting at about maybe now. Oh no, that's terrible driving. My goodness. What would you say, Brian? It's probably about, what, 35 kilometers an hour, 40 k's an hour now? So what's that, about maybe 15 miles, 10 miles, somewhere around there? So it's not too bad at the moment, but we are expecting winds quite high. They were estimating at 160 kilometers. I think that's probably just over... I don't know. Actually, I'm terrible. I can't do that conversion. I'll leave it. But it's really windy. And that type of wind is enough to blow over marulas and a couple of other trees. And especially some of those trees that you've seen that the elephants have ring barked. And say it's a leadwood or even a knobthorn, a marula that's been standing around for many, many years. And of course, that tree is not alive anymore and becomes weaker and weaker. So those trees are also... well, they could blow over, so we've got to be careful. I've heard of a couple of times guides driving around, and while I was working in the southern sands, where they would drive, and as they'd gone past, trees would just fall just behind them on top of the road. So you've got to be very, very careful. So even on those exceptionally windy days, my guess, I'm coming from the Eastern Cape of South Africa, but Port Elizabeth is the windiest city that we have in the country, and sort of further up along the coastline, quite close to where James is from, Kenton-on-Sea. I worked on a reserve close to there, and many days the wind would be gusting almost 100 kilometers an hour, and you have to just say to your guests, it's not safe to go out there. To have a tree fall on top of your vehicle, you can imagine, that's a nightmare. These silver cluster leaves that are just on the side of the road could very well fall down. I don't know if you saw, there was a little woodpecker that flew in front of the screen. I think it looked like very quickly, looked quite small, so I presume it was probably a cardinal. That's actually surprising me. I've seen quite a few birds as we're moving along here, but the problem, of course, with the roof is that they fly too high and then they perch themselves up on really big... Don't fly. Don't fly. Okay, I'm going to be very nice, European roller. I said such nice things about you the other day. Hello, thank you very much. A beautiful European roller. And you may recall the other day when I was on Cheetah Plains, that I'd said that I'm impressed with the European rollers, and I think that they are much more well behaved than the lilac breasted and the purple rollers, because they always fly off. They would never have sat here and allowed me to reposition the vehicle. But luckily enough, they didn't. They won't be here for too much longer, a few more months. I think they leave around April. Hello. Are you enjoying drying off your feathers now after that downpour that we had earlier? I always feel sorry for the birds, because when you're not something that's used to getting wet, you know, you're not like a duck that has an oil to try and waterproof your feathers, it must be really, really tough when they get too saturated and you can't fly very well. And then, of course, with saturated feathers and then trying to fly in the wind, especially the way it's gusting at the moment, that can't be too pleasant. But there we go, Wayne. You can see you can use this bird as a wind gauge or a windsock. Is that it has subsided slightly, and now it's just acting as a hairdryer, all fluffed up, making sure all those little feathers underneath the wing and on its breast get nice and dry. Its little feathers on its head is still a bit wet though. Aren't they lovely birds? And I know they're not you can't compare them to the lilac-breasted roller because they're not quite as colourful, but I think that what they lack in colour, it really does make up in their personality. Well, they make up for it in their personality. Having to hold on a little bit longer. I love that though. You don't really get to appreciate birds too often, especially so close to the vehicle. We only are probably about 10 feet from this bird. Look at the beautiful browns and those sort of blues with the slight undertones of the grey coming through as well. Got his little toes wrapped around that branch. You can see the drizzling now coming through. I wouldn't sit out there for too long because you're going to get wet very quickly. Oh, you are a beautiful bird. You see that little hook on its beak? Now that little hook on its beak over there, that's very typical of an insect eater. And I saw an incredible picture the other day that was floating around on a South African bird group of a lilac-breasted roller eating a nestling, eating a little chick that hadn't even had any of its feathers developed yet, which I thought was very interesting. Normally they prey upon insects, so caterpillars and grasshoppers and moths and butterflies and dung beetles. But I never would have thought that they would have gone for something like a little chick. Now, Shandli, you were wondering if all the animals will stay out in the different types of weather. It depends. Like, this rain is getting heavier now, and I suspect that this roller is probably going to dive down and go and hide away in a nearby shrub, because it did look like it was trying to dry its feathers off, and if it sits there, well, that's not going to do a good job. It's just going to get wet again. And this is actually a good spot. We're not getting wet at all. We're just sitting here with our bums towards the wind and with the rain. And we're staying quite dry. So we're going to carry on and very quickly see if we can get one look at Sydney's dam. But I'm sure that James Hendry is missing you lots and all of your chats. So I think let's go across to him and see if he's got rain on his side.
I do have a little bit of rain on my side, but you'll see that VM has very bravely opened up the left-hand side of the vehicle because he couldn't see anything out of it. He said he felt like he was travelling in a hearse, which I thought was quite amusing. It's not as bad as... Oh, I think that's worse, in fact, than travelling in a hot dog-selling mobile, which is what I feel like I'm doing without the hot dogs, of course. I'm not sad about not having hot dogs. An excellent meal for lunch, courtesy of Amanda. Jaw. How do you spell jaw, Kirsten? Oh, Joel. Oh, I see. Joel. All right, there we go. Joel, you want to know if animals smell more when they're wet? I think that the cats don't. I think the hyenas probably pong something cruel right now. And I think the wild dogs, wherever they happen to be, will be setting a cloud of yuckiness around them. They will definitely smell like a very shaggy, wet Labrador that hasn't had a proper shampoo for many years. Hyenas... When they are wet, I know that hyenas smell when they're wet. They're pretty foul when they're wet. So I think, yes, the hyenas will smell. I don't think anyone else smells very bad. I think the cats are fastidiously clean, and they might just smell a little bit, but not appreciably. Hyenas, definitely. I've been around, being at a hyena den, after a rainy night or after there's been a lot of dew around, yes, then they can really smell very, very foul. And it's a sweet, sickly smell. It's really unpleasant. It's not like the wild dogs, which is actually not too bad. You know, it's like a wet, shaggy dog. Liam, do you think we'd dare carry on going to the east? And Anna, yes, to a certain extent, they do have oils to... Animals do have oils to remain dry or to waterproof their skin. Not to the same extent that birds do. But yes, animals do have oil in the same way that your hair has got oil. And if you're like Gendre, well, you are of the belief that that oil is there to sort of self-clean your hair. And I mean, to a large extent, that is true. But of course, we wash the oil out of our hair because we don't like it very much. Well, most of us. Well, and those of us who have hair, of course. But animals, yes, definitely have oil glands in their hair. Right, Tayla has gone off to one of the waterholes to see if this giant cyclone has managed to put any water in it, because it was previously empty. Let us find out.
I cannot believe it. We came to Sydney's dam and all I expected to see was a couple of pools of water, and we've got a lot more than what we've bargained for. We've got an African fish eagle eating a fish. Can you believe this? Isn't this wonderful? Now, unfortunately, as you know, Sydney's dam is not on our traverse and it's quite a distance away. So it does make it difficult. He's zoomed in as he can go. But if you watch very, very carefully, you'll see every now and then this fish uses its large feet with its talons. This fish uses its large not the fish. The fish eagle uses its large feet with its talons to pull bits of flesh. And I think it looks like a fish. I could imagine there must be some large catfish in here. And that's really interesting and quite special. It's the first time I've actually seen the fish eagles eating something since I've been here at Safari Live. We usually used to see it a lot in the Eastern Cape, in catching big kabeljau from the tidal rivers, so they were salty. And we'd see them feasting on them. And I actually had seen the jackal buzzard before, which is another bird of prey. We don't get them up here, sadly. They would also sort of feast upon the leftovers of the African fish eagle. Look at that. That is really amazing. Now, it's pretty impressive, the weight that the fish eagle can actually carry. Because if you've ever seen any photos, I think it's on every guide's or top of their list of things to photograph, and I'm sure Tristan is probably sitting going yes, and I wonder if Tristan has ever experienced this. I don't know if any of the guides have, but actually managed to capture a shot of a fish eagle grabbing a fish and then sort of taking off with it. I mean, that's the ideal shot to get something like that, but you've got to have a lot of patience, and you've also got to sit in an area, I suppose, where fish eagles are prolific. So on the Zambezi River or in the Okavango Delta, you'd probably have a very good chance. Sometimes it's smaller at these, it's harder at some of these smaller pools. And I'll tell you another story. Today is now reminiscing about the old days. And when I was guiding in the south with the drought, and you all saw how horrific it was, and it was particularly bad at the beginning of 2016, January and February, that's when I found that it was the worst for us down south. And there's a big dam positioned down in front of one of the lodges, and there was a pair of African fish. She swooped down, there was lots of tilapia and catfish that sort of naturally occurred in this pool. And we were very lucky, we had a pod of hippos that lived there, sort of ranged between about 3 and 13 hippos that lived in that pool. It was always nice waking up to those beautiful sounds. But then, with the drought, most of the other dams had dried out and we were pumping water into this dam. Oh, fish eagle, have you had enough now? You're just sitting up on some dung. And that didn't really do a good job of perching yourself on anything. And I think it's full now. I wonder if it's going to have a drink. Let's see. I'll finish my story in a moment. It's a long one, but it's interesting. What are you doing now? I wondered if it was going to go and have a drink. Sort of, you know how predators will often go and have a big gulp of water after they've been feasting. I'm sure birds do very much the same thing. Anyways, with my story, it's about fish eagles, I promise. So the drought got really horrific, and it was one of the few dams that had lots of water in. But it would probably... Oh, that was wonderful. I think I'm going to have to reposition quickly. Let me see if I can just go back a little bit and just turn the vehicle slightly. Because now our friend the fish eagle is hiding. No, it's flying. Flying back into a better spot. There we go. And and ended up happening is all the hippos came down to this dam. At one point we had 30 hippos in this pool of water. Can you believe it? Now you know how filthy water becomes after hippos, buffalo, elephants have been wallowing, drinking, defecating, urinating in it, and particularly with the hippos, it caused a big problem. And what happened is that basically the water became toxic. There was no oxygen left in the water. The one afternoon I'd gone down because there was quite a bit of commotion with the fish eagles. We could hear them calling. So we went down to see what was happening, and what actually caught my eye was this glimmer of sort of silver along the edge of the water. It was the fish. They were all dying. They were basically taking their last breaths. And all that had happened, like I said, is that all from the feces and urine from probably mainly the hippos, but then as well as the buffalo, they'd all died. And then the fish eagles moved in. Now, fish eagles are territorial birds, so they don't like to have a lot of friends around them. You know, they'll have their partner, and then that's really it, and possibly a juvenile on, you know, sort of section of a river or at a dam. Like here you'd normally see maybe one or two hanging around you. I think the most I've seen at Sydney's is about three. We had, I think there were eight birds in total. Four pairs of African fish eagles. I don't know if they were all together. They looked like there were one or two juveniles as well. Now, can you imagine this competition that was now created because of all the food that was around this dam? It was unbelievable. It wasn't really, it was something very interesting. Anyways, what happened was we ended up having to put a fence around the dam once the hippos had left at night so that we could give the water some time to sort of settle and oxygenate itself. We pumped fresh water in, and a couple of months later, we were able to open it up and the hippos could come on in. But it was just really interesting to see the competition amongst all the fish eagles. Not that there was too much competition because all the fish were dead already, and it really were just helping us with being the cleanup crew and eating all that nasty fish, because you know what that can smell like. Right, but that was wonderful. What a great day of birds. We're going to go back across to James now, and it sounds like the rain is getting a little bit heavier on his side.
It is getting heavy, everybody. Vim is now just shooting a little bit for what we call catch-up clips, so that when we do the TV on it's Monday, Sunday for you in North America, 11 o'clock Eastern Standard Time in the night, Nat.Geo Wild. And that's what it looks like. Now, VM said, is that coming towards us? And it isn't. It's moving in from the southeast, and so where we're sitting now, it actually feels all right. It doesn't feel too bad. It did get quite a lot heavier while we were heading this way. Well, we'll carry on, see what happens. I think we're going to start making our way back towards home, though, just in case, because it's really starting to look quite ominous. We got a little bit wet there, and apparently it's quite heavy at Sydney's dam. But these covers are very effective if you're driving with the wind. If you're driving into the wind, however, they are, well, virtually useless. Some long-billed crombecks, which were very nice. And there's an impala, can't show you, unfortunately. And Debbie, yes, they do. It's exactly what they do. You say, do the termites close their mounds in this kind of weather? Do they close the tops of their mounds? Yes, they do. They put very quickly, the workers will put a seal over the top of the mound, and then they'll open it up again as soon as the weather stops. It's so clever. And I don't think we're really very close to understanding the mechanism by which they all know exactly what to do, when to do it. I mean, how does a termite with a brain smaller than a pinhead know, and all of its friends know, to go and close the mound up? It really is quite astonishing. Now, it's always a good thing to be in the south of the reserve when the rain starts, so that you can turn your back to the south and head north. At the moment, we're okay. There was a bit of a squall. Seems to have finished for now. So we'll just keep going. We're still looking for those little cubs, but of course there are no tracks now, so it's very difficult to tell where on earth they've gone. lovely puddles all over the place. We haven't had those for a while. And I was astounded, you know. I went off to Cheetah Plains yesterday, had a beautiful sighting of some cheetah. And I was astounded by how much greener it is than it is here at Djuma. And the rain is so isolated in these areas. And I mean, it looks, it's long and green and verdant there compared with quarantine clearings. It's just, it's another world. But that will change now. We'll all get quite a lot of nice greenery growing up, I'm sure. You may have noticed we've put all the flaps down again. There's a large herd of kudu off to the side, which I'm afraid I cannot show you on account of the roof. They don't look like they've seen any leopards. They might have. The whoop whoop. James, you're wondering about long-lasting effects after a storm like this, and what sort of long-lasting effects can we expect to see from a time like this, if any? The answer, James, is not many. You know, I mean, erosion, certainly, on some of the roads, perhaps. This is not a very hectic storm, though. It's going to last for 2 days, but it's not that hectic. It's going to bring probably about 50 millimeters of rain, maybe 60 millimeters, so 3 or 4 inches. It's really not going to bring a massive amount. And so, yes, there will be a little bit of erosion caused on the roads, and there will be erosion caused on the dam walls. But other than that, I really don't think there'll be long-lasting effects. It's quite unlike the giant cyclones of the year 2000, which did irrevocably change various parts of this landscape, making rivers much wider, destroying some areas, pushing trees over, inundating banks of rivers so that pulled trees over, and then, you know, closing other parts up. But this isn't anything like that. This barely qualifies anymore as a cyclone. It's probably now, I think it's been downgraded to a tropical storm, whatever that means. Tropical depression. Have you ever had a tropical depression, Liam? Sounds like quite a pleasant depression to have, don't you think?
Yes.
I don't mean to make light of depression. I know it's not fun at all for anyone. But a tropical depression is probably the best kind to have. And back where we started looking for those cubs. Now, this could lead us all the way down the road of conspiracy, I suppose. Take care, you say, do we ever seed rain? Rain ever seeded out here? Not as far as I know. I don't actually know the mechanism of seeding rain, but I think, and my understanding of it is extremely poor. It's poorer probably than my understanding of string theory, which is pretty much zero. But my impression is that if you're going to seed rain, you need quite a lot more in the way of clouds. I think you can seed a cloud. I don't think you can form a cloud, can you? I don't know, actually. But no, as far as I'm aware, there is no rain seeding going on here. This is dinkum real rain come from the heavens. So I'd love to know a bit more about rain seeding, if you'd like to tell me something about it while we drive around here hoping desperately to find an animal or two. So I think these cubs have moved on. So what we will try and do, I'm just going to put my hand out the car to check what's coming from the southeast. No, it still seems to be okay. We'll head off towards Treehouse Dam or Ingwe Alley and see if the cats haven't ended up there. They do like that area. There was a report of some elephants that Rexon saw. He's driving out of Wiertela, but apparently those elephants were in some deeply thick bush, which we suspected they would be. And so we haven't gone towards them. Was there any water in Sydney's dam? Well, not yet. I suspect not. No, there was. Well, that's good. There's another Impala, Vim. Shall we film it? I think it could easily be the same one we had earlier. Stay there, please. Oi! He doesn't seem to be too miserable about life. And I think it's because they're not cold. This wind is very warm. It's not a cold wind at all. Which is unusual. I suppose it's because it's coming off the front. All right, let's carry on. Keep forgetting that you can't actually see anything once it moves. Sort of beyond that, beyond 10 degrees off centre. Now, Swatna, you ask a very good question, of course. Is a cyclone the same as a hurricane? Yes, it is, but it's found in a different part of the world. As far as I understand it, a hurricane and a cyclone and a typhoon are caused by precisely the same things, where I think there's a temperature differential between the air and the water, which in turn creates swirling air currents, and those then in turn cause this sort of turning eye of the storm, which eventually will suck in all sorts of other weather. I don't have a very good understanding of it clearly. But a cyclone is found in the Indian Ocean. A hurricane is found in the Western Atlantic. And a typhoon, I think, is found in the South China Sea, if I'm not mistaken. I think those are the differences. But I think the phenomena that make them all are very similar. Right, Taylor has come south from Sydney's dam. She is close to home. So let's find out if there is anything close to home. There were those elephants, so perhaps she'll find them.
There isn't much close to home at the moment. We had one impala that was very rude. I asked so nicely if it could please stay so that we could have a look at it. But then I think I know why I chased it away, is because I said that it was the fattest impala I've ever seen. Probably slightly offended, and then, well, it ran away, which was a little bit disappointing, because it was just so nice to see how healthy all the animals are. Elephants! As I said, elephants, I'm going to go right back. I need to try and reverse, because there's a couple of trees that are going to block our way, but I can see a nice gap. Here we go. Are you ready? Oh. Okay, let's do this. It's going to pull off the road slightly. Now, it may not look like there's some elephants. You just got to watch at that big marula tree, or the one that's fallen over too. And there we go. You can see them very, very quietly moving around at the back. And I think they're changing direction. I think they're going to come straight towards us now. Sorry, excuse me. I have a hiccups. Let me hold my breath for 2 seconds. No, I don't think it's going to work. Someone asked me when last did I see a white horse. But yay, my favorite animal out on this rainy, gloomy day. And I think that this big cow in front, you can see she's slightly nervous. See how her ears are sort of just positioned slightly away from her head, and every now and then she keeps lifting her head. There's the little ones catching up. And that's because of the wind. Or because there's a big elephant bull following them, I think. You'll see him now, Brian, but he's actually just popped out. There he is. That could be another reason as to maybe why she's slightly agitated. is because of this fella. And it's unusual. I was just about to say, I'm surprised that she's come out. And I thought that maybe, and it was very silly of me to even think that, because we know how intelligent these creatures are. And I was going to say, maybe she thought that the gloomy weather was over. But this is a lot clearer to me now as to why she's left her hidey hole in the drainage line, just sort of below from where she is, where that male elephant has come from, is because I think she's being pushed and being chased after by this elephant bull. So it will be interesting to see if he catches up to her. She has got a very young elephant calf, so she's probably going to be a bit protective. Let's see how this plays out. We'll watch him, and as soon as he moves out of and behind these trees, we'll get a nice clear view of him, and then we'll have to reverse and reposition again. Oh, look, he might shake the tree. Are you going to shake the tree? He's stretching up. Please shake the tree, Mr. Elephant. Nope. Maybe he's had enough of marulas now. Here's out. Big swagger. I can't smell anything at the moment, but his whole disposition says must. Hello, Anna. Anna, you've said that you think that the elephants look like they're quite enjoying the rain. It's actually going to be quite tricky. I think we'll actually stay here. Let's see. Just because they're going behind a tree now. Okay, they're going to come out. So we should be able to reposition in a moment. Anna, they do. You know, you have some incredible sightings of elephants, but when there's not a lot of wind. So some days we get these very, very rainy days, but the animals are still about. As soon as you get this sort of very strong wind that we've got at the moment, it's not great. I think let's reposition. Let me quickly reverse a little bit. And then I'll go to the next gap. Oh, this is wonderful. I'm so happy that we came onto quarantine. And a buffalo. Hang on, I have to show you the buffalo. Just to say that we got two, a whole herd. I don't know where to go. Okay, I'll just show you quickly the buffalo. There they are. And then we'll go back to the elephants. Hi, guys. It's all happening out here this afternoon. Yes, you. You four. We're talking about you. Isn't this wonderful? What a nice surprise. And I'm not saying this. I love buffalo, but I love elephants more. And I think that all of you enjoy. Interesting to watch. I think let's go back and watch this interaction with these elephants, and then we know where the buffalo are. Maybe they come and join the party with the elephants. Wouldn't that be nice? That'd be ideal. But I'd love to see what's going to happen with this big Ellie bull and how he decides to approach this female, seeing as though she's got quite a few youngsters with her. Oh, thank you for coming out into the open. I hope there's not a tree behind me. Nope, didn't hear a bang. There we go. That's nice. So he's actually come in. He sort of came in with a big swagger, ears out, and then he settled down. He sort of calmed down a little bit, and you can see that she's actually tolerating him, feeding amongst her and her little ones. She's got three calves. Let's see. I think she's sort of saying, come on guys, let's go, let's not get too comfortable. And I lied, there's not just five buffalo, it looks like there's probably about 15 buffalo. But the elephants are now walking towards them. Ooh, wonderful. Let's see how this plays out. My goodness, the buffalo are walking directly towards the elephants. There was a little bit of a trumpet there. I think it was from one of the youngsters. Now, Anthony, you're wondering if elephants are more aggressive in the rain. No, not necessarily. I think it can make them a little bit more cautious because they aren't able to hear things as well. Remember, when the rain comes pelting down, it does muffle sound quite a lot. And they rely on their main senses. So when one of those aren't as clear as what they should be. There's a couple of buffalo running from the back now, trying to catch up with the rest of the herd. He's a little bit antsy. I don't think mom elephant is going to enjoy buffalo running towards her. But this is fantastic. I'm going to keep an eye out here. See, they're quite close. I don't know why they're going over there. So now, I don't think that they're any more aggressive, but elephants aren't typically aggressive. They really are placid creatures, and I think you've really got to upset an elephant or catch an elephant on a bad day. See that young calf reacting to the sight of the buffalo? Mom's now reacting as well. She's got her tail raised. Big Ellie Bull's going to shake the tree. Where do we look? This is fantastic. This is so cool. Did you see how brothers and sisters came around and went to fetch the young, inexperienced calf and sort of said, come on, move on. Go back to mom. Buffalo, what on earth are you thinking? Now they've all stopped and they're just staring at the elephant. Oh, there they go again. They're going straight towards them. Are you crazy? We actually used to see this a lot in Zambia, where you'd quite happily see elephants and buffalo mixing on the big open plains. But there, they were massive herds. Little one, careful now. I think you're biting off a bit more than you can chew. Although I suppose elephants are always brave when mom's around, and there's also a big bull around. Oh, let's see. So in Zambia, you would see a herd of like 100 elephants, and maybe a herd of 1,000 buffalo, and they'd all just be grazing on the massive open plains and sort of quite comfortable with each other, but keeping a respectable distance apart. Hello, girl, you're very brave. I don't know if I'd want to walk past elephants. Oh, that's beautiful. I think if you can, grab a couple of screenshots, because this is really, really beautiful, especially when the rest of the herd of buffalo come passing through. Oh, this is divine. See, this is something new. This is something I haven't seen since I've been at Safari Live. Quick link to James. Off we go.
There, everybody, the European golden oriole, never seen before on camera as far as I'm aware. I certainly haven't managed to get one on camera before, and there is this beautiful, beautiful bird. Look at that bright golden bird with black wings. That's so cool. I'm so happy about that. I've seen them fly over hundreds of times today. All right, quickly, let's go back to Tayla and her wonderful elephant.
It is, isn't this cool? I think this is amazing. This is probably one of the nicest sightings I've had, and it's actually amazing behavior. Oh, sorry. That elephant cow is actually sort of nudged up against that Ellie Bull. And I wonder if she was maybe a little bit put off by those buffalo walking towards them. She's sort of cowering behind him. I don't know if it's just coincidence, but she went right behind him just as we left you. And they're happy together. It's like a little happy family. But of course, as you know, the big Ellie Bulls, they don't hang around the herds for too long. They just come and go. And that was actually a very nice interaction, wasn't it? I think they all understand each other today. And there's also one of the reasons why they might not be so stressed with each other's presence is the fact that there's so much food around. I think if this was winter, there would probably be a very different story. I think there might have been a little bit of animosity between the two species just because they're all competing for the same food. Hey, and the oxpeckers are even around. That's nice. Hello, guys. We're going to lose the buffalo now. Just sorry, unfortunately, with these roofs, it does make it very difficult to keep positioning. But thank you, buffalo, for passing through. That was wonderful. But we'll stick with the elephants, my favorite. Isn't that cool? We've had elephants shaking the marula tree. Then one elephant sort of acting big and brave and trying to chase the buffalo. And then one elephant cowering behind another elephant. It's been wonderful. And this is the greatest thing about going on a safari, is that you should never let the weather dictate what you're going to do. And like my Irish guest, the story I told you earlier, you persist, and then often you're rewarded for being brave and going out in the weather like this. So James, I'm sorry that you didn't get to see this, but I am very jealous that you got to see a Eurasian oriole. That's very, very nice. I've never had one sit still for long enough that I've ever been able to get a photo. I've only seen them about three or four times before. Oh, we got a bit of an itch. He seems to be a lovely elephant bull with lovely manners. And I can't tell you if he's in must or not because of him, well, the fact that he's completely covered by the rain. So I can't really see if he's dribbling urine. And I can't see that he's secreting anything from his temporal gland. So he might not even be too interested in this female. Perhaps he's actually just a bull that's passing by. He picked up on her scent and, you know, just sort of came through, greeted, and then moved off. But normally when you see the bulls coming through in must, the females are normally a bit agitated. And she was agitated initially. And maybe now that she's realized that his intentions are maybe slightly different. I'm not sure. We'll have to wait and see how it goes. Maybe that's why she's gone, okay, whew, I'm out of the woods this time. But this is lovely. And it's a good size comparison as well, compared to a fully grown elephant cow on the left versus a very big elephant bull. And I don't think he's probably about between 35 and 40 years old, so he could still even get a little bit bigger. And compare the two of them to a marula tree. Isn't that amazing? That was a nice little scale that we've got over there. But I know James is probably dying to tell you a little bit more about that very special bird that he saw.
Well, the only thing I can tell you is that it goes to Europe, it eats insects, and I think it's the second most beautiful bird that I can think of out here. Now, we're following some hyena tracks towards this den that Herbert found the other day. We'll just have a quick look in there and see if there isn't a hyena there. But the first most beautiful bird is the African golden oriole, I think. Now, that's not to say it's my favorite bird, but it is, I think, the best looking bird. And the African golden oriole looks even golder than that wonderful European oriole, and it just doesn't have as much black on the wings. And many of you saying that is a new bird for your bird list. I'm very pleased. I think they're so lovely. But at least we've had that. We've had some very nice elephants and buffalo with Tayla. We've had an impala and a nyala, and now maybe we'll have a hyena. Will we? Will we maybe?